This session, today we are going to discuss about intestinal protozoa, especially those which are pathogenic to man, those which cause infections in humans. And we are also going to see what is the importance of stool routine microscopy or stool examination in order to identify these intestinal protozoa so that the disease can be diagnosed. So first coming to what are protozoa? So these are eukaryotes and they belong to kingdom Protista. They are unicellular forms in which a single cell performs all the functions like reproduction, digestion, respiration and excretion. Coming to what are intestinal protozoa? These are the protozoa those inhabit the intestine. That means they are found either in the small intestine or in the large intestine. So which are these pathogenic intestinal protozoa? So here we have a table which shows us the intestinal protozoa which are pathogenic to man. So we first have end amoeba histolytica, which is found in the large intestine and which causes amoebic dysentery and liver abscess. Then we have Giardia lamblia, which is seen in the small intestine, which causes malabsorption and diarrhea. Next, coming to Balanitidium coli, it is seen in the large intestine and causes dysentery. Then we have Isospora belli, Cryptosporidium parvum, Cyclospora cytinensis and Microsporidia, which are all seen in the small intestine and cause diarrhea in people with AIDS. Next, coming to this, that they all have a direct life cycle. So what is this direct life cycle? So it is when parasite requires only one single host to complete its development. The parasite completes its life cycle in a single host. In intestinal protozoa, man acts as a host. Coming to the life cycle of Entamoeba histolytica, man acquires infection by ingestion of contaminated food and water. The food and water is contaminated with mature quadrinucleate cyst. This is the infective form. The cyst passes to the stomach. It reaches the stomach and the cyst wall is resistant to acids and so it escapes the gastric acidity and then it passes down to the lower part of the ileum or cecum. So it comes here. So now we have a quadrinucleate cyst. This quadrinucleate cyst exists to transform into quadrinucleate metacyst. This metacyst transforms into 8 amoebulae by binary fission, and these amoebulae invade the submucosa and transform into trophozoite. Trophozoites are the young forms of the parasite. These trophozoites form colonic ulcers. They produce colonic ulcers. They cause necrosis of the tissue and this tissue is sloughed off. These trophozoites then further incyst, turn to a cyst. They first transform into a binucleate cyst, a cyst with 2 nuclei. Then they transform to a quadrinucleate cyst, a cyst with 4 nuclei. And these cysts are passed in the feces and contaminates the food and water, and again the life cycle continues. So a person suffers with intestinal amoebiasis and manifests as dysentery. So we can have a stool examination for that, in which we can look for the presence of cysts and trophozoites and also blood and mucus, because the person is suffering with dysentery. So a person with Entamoeba histolytica infections has intestinal amoebiasis. Intestinal amoebiasis may also complicate and have certain sequelae which are explained. So a person with intestinal amoebiasis has amoebic ulcer. This ulcer is typically flask shaped. The bottom of the ulcer is broader than the neck. The amoebic ulcer consists of trophozoites of Entamoeba histolytica. These trophozoites reach the liver. fibrozoids in the liver cause liver abscess. This abscess or this pus is called as ankylosing sauce pus, typically because of its appearance. It is dark brown in color. This liver abscess may rupture into different sites. The liver abscess may rupture into the abdominal parietes. It may rupture below the diaphragm to cause saphenic abscess. It may rupture into the pleural cavity to cause empyema. It may rupture to the lungs to cause lung abscess. It may rupture to the pericardial cavity to cause pericarditis. It may rupture into the stomach to cause hematemesis with pus. A person vomits out pus. The abscess may rupture into the peritoneal cavity to cause peritonitis. So that was intestinal amebiasis and complications of intestinal amebiasis, which is caused by Entamoeba histolytica. Apart from this pathogenic species of Entamoeba histolytica, there are certain non-pathogenic species of Entamoeba also. These are Entamoeba disper, Entamoeba coli, Entamoeba hartmanni, and Endonimax nana. Coming to the life cycle of Giardia lamblia and Balanoidium coli. Giardia lamblia is a flagellate, that means it has a flagella, and Balanoidium coli is a ciliate, that means it possesses cilia. The life cycle of both Giardia lamblia and Balanoidium coli is combined here because it has similarities. So, man acquires infection by ingestion of cyst in contaminated food and water. In Balanoidium coli, there are animal carriers like pigs, rats, and monkeys which act as a source of infection. This Balanoidium coli, so therefore, causes zoonosis. Primarily, these animals are affected and humans acquire the infection from the animals. So, coming to the life cycle again. So, after the cyst is ingested by human, it goes down to the intestine and exists. In case of Giardia lamblia, exudation takes place in the duodenum, and in Balanoidium coli, it is done in the small intestine. After exudation, a trophozoite is formed, and this trophozoite multiplies in the small intestine by binary fission. This trophozoite further insists and produces or converts or transforms into a cyst. These cysts are passed in the feces and they again contaminate food and water which is ingested by a healthy person, and the life cycle continues. So, in case of Balanoidium coli, a person suffers with diarrhea and dysentery. And in case of Giardia lamblia, a person suffers with mucus diarrhea and fat malabsorption, which is also called as steatorrhea. So, we can have stool examination and look for cysts and trophozoites in the specimen. Coming to the life cycle of Isospora belli, Cryptosporidium parvum, and Cyclospora cytonensis. Again, these life cycles are explained collectively because they have certain similarities. So, we have the infective form, which is called as an oocyst. In all these protozoa, we have oocyst, which is ingested along with contaminated food and water. Mostly water. These oocysts reach the small intestine and exist. and transform into different morphological forms. Finally, they again incyst, turn to a oocyst, and this oocyst is again passed in the feces, which contaminates water, which is ingested by a healthy person, and the life cycle continues. The person suffers with diarrhea. So again, we can have stool examination to look for the presence of oocysts, which appear colorless. Then we can also perform the modified Zeal Alescence staining. These oocysts are acid fast, so we can perform the staining technique and look for the presence of acid fast oocysts in the feces. Coming to the life cycle of Microsporidia, these protozoa have spores as the infective form. Spores are ingested or inhaled, and the developmental stages continue in the small intestine. Finally, again a spore is formed, which is released in the environment. And these spores are again ingested or inhaled by a healthy person, and the life cycle continues. The person suffers with diarrhea. We can have stool examination and look for the presence of spores. We can perform Gram staining, the periodic acid shift staining, or the trichrome staining technique. So coming to the importance of stool examination, now that we have seen that all these intestinal protozoa, they have certain stages in the life cycle, which are passed in the feces, and we can observe the feces to detect these morphological forms. So let's see what is stool examination now. So coming to the collection of the specimen, so feces is collected freshly. The freshly passed feces should be collected. It should be collected in a clean, wide mouth, disinfectant free plastic container. Cardboard boxes and match boxes should not be used. The specimen should not be contaminated with water, urine, or disinfectants. The liquid stool should be examined within 30 minutes of passage. Soft stool should be examined within 1 hour, and firm stool should be examined within 24 hours. So for stool examination, we can prepare wet mounts. First, we may have a saline mount. So we take a slide and take a drop of normal saline. To this normal saline, we emulsify the specimen. We mix the stool specimen in the normal saline and put a cover slip. We should take care that air bubbles are not seen. Then we screen the slide under the microscope. We observe it through the microscope. We use a low power objective to screen the slide, and anything suspicious is observed at the high power so that it can be identified. So making a saline mount will help us to look for the live motile trophozoites, especially of Amoeba histolytica, Giardia lamblia, and Balanidium coli. We can see these trophozoites moving around in the field. Then we can also observe eggs of helminths in this preparation. Next, coming to iodine staining of wet mouths, we use Leucol's iodine. This is prepared with 100 ml distilled water, in which 5 grams of iodine is added and 10 grams of potassium iodide is added. So Leucol's iodine is a mixture of all these three components. Iodine mount helps us to confirm the identity of the cyst. The internal structures of the cyst are observed very clearly. The cytoplasm stains yellow, the glycogen material stains brown, and the refractile nuclei stains pale yellow. Sometimes when the parasites are scanty in the stool and routine microscopy fails to detect them repeatedly, we can perform stool concentration methods. In stool concentration method, we concentrate the number of the parasites in the entire specimen so that the sensitivity of microscopy increases so that we can easily find out the parasites in the specimen. There are different methods for stool concentration. We have the flotation method and we have the sedimentation method. In the flotation method, the stool specimen is suspended in a liquid with high specific gravity. So the parasite forms float on the surface. In flotation methods, we have the saturated salt solution technique, which is used to observe eggs of roundworms, hookworms, and ribworms, but it cannot be used for observation of protozoan cyst, eggs of tapeworms, and unfertilized egg of roundworm. Nextly, we have the zinc sulfate centrifugal flotation technique. It is good for protozoan cysts, eggs of nematodes and small tapeworms, but not for unfertilized roundworm eggs, nematode larvae, and eggs of most trematodes and large tapeworms. Nextly, we have the sugar flotation technique, which is good for cryptosporidia. Next, coming to the sedimentation methods, in which the specimen is suspended in a liquid of low specific gravity so that the parasitic forms settle at the bottom. So we have the formal ether sedimentation technique, which is good for all helminth eggs and protozoan cysts. Next, we have the Behrman concentration method, which is good for observing the larvae. Coming to certain interesting facts about the intestinal protozoa. So there are some parasites which cause traveler's diarrhea. So these are Cryptosporidium parvum, Entamoeba histolytica, Giardia lamblia, and Cyclospora cytinensis. Then we have the acid fast parasitic organisms, or the acid fast parasites. So these are Microsporidia. The spore of Microsporidia is acid fast. Then we have Cyclospora cytinensis, Isospora belli, and Cryptosporium, the oocysts of which are acid fast. When we are observing the specimen of dysentery caused by Entamoeba histolytica, we also have to differentiate it from bacillary dysentery. The dysentery caused by Entamoeba histolytica is called as amoebic dysentery, and the one which is caused by Shigella is called as bacillary dysentery. So we need to differentiate both of them. So coming to the differential features, first we will see the clinical features. In amoebic dysentery, the onset is slow, fever is absent, toxicity is absent, and abdominal tenderness is also absent. In bacillary dysentery, onset is acute, fever, toxicity, and abdominal tenderness is present. Coming to the macroscopic appearance of stool or passage of stool. So in amoebic dysentery, the frequency of passage of stool is 6 to 8 per day. The odor is offensive, color is dark red. The nature of the feces is that it is mixed with blood and mucus. Consistency is non-adherent, that means it doesn't stick to the container, and it is acidic in reaction. Whereas that of bacillary dysentery, the frequency of passage of stool is over 10 per day. It is odorless. The specimen is odorless. Color is bright red. Blood and mucus with little or no feces is present. The consistency is adherent, that means it adheres or sticks to the container, and it is alkaline in reaction. Coming to the microscopic appearance of the stool or stool microscopy, in amoebic dysentery, cellular exudate is scanty. RBCs appear in clumps. There are few macrophages. Eosinophils may be present. Motile bacteria are present. The commensals are seen in the specimen. And amoebae, as far as amoebae is concerned, the motile trophozoites may be seen with ingested RBCs. These trophozoites ingest the RBCs, which can also be seen. Whereas in bacillary dysentery, there is abundant cellular exudate. RBCs are discrete or in rulo. Rulo are in stalks, stalked appearance, as we stalk coins. There may be several macrophages seen. Eosinophils are absent. Motile bacteria are absent, and amoeba are also absent. So, coming to the appearances or diagrams of these protozoan forms. So, first we have a diagram of trophozoite of Entamoeba histolytica. So, this is an amoeboid form. So, it has pseudopodia, it has ectoplasm and endoplasm. The nucleus is present and the ingested RBCs can also be seen. Next, coming to the diagram of cyst of Entamoeba histolytica in iodine mounts. So, the cyst contains nuclei, chromatoid bodies and glycogen masses. Coming to the diagram of appearance of stool in acute amoebic dysentery. So, as we have discussed earlier, that we can see presence of trophozoites of Entamoeba histolytica in the specimen. So, this is a trophozoite, especially with the ingested RBCs. The RBCs outside are seen in clumps. Eggs of Ascaris lumbricoides. First, we have the unfertilized egg. So, this egg is having an atrophic ovum. So, this ovum is atrophic. The ovum is enclosed in egg shell. So, we have an egg shell. There are many disorganized, highly refractile granules present in the ovum. So, these are the granules. There is no space between the ovum and the eggshell. So, no space over here. The albuminous coat is thin. So, we have this albuminous coat, which is very thin and irregular. And the egg does not float on saturated salt solution. Coming to fertilized decorticated egg of Ascaris lumbricoides. Here the albuminous coat is absent, so it doesn't have the albuminous coat. A clear crescentric area is present between the ovum and the eggshell. So this is the clear crescentric area. Ovum is unsegmented and it floats on saturated solution of corn salt. Coming to the fertilized egg of Ascaris lumbricoides, the clear crescentric area is present between the ovum and the eggshell. Eggshell is covered by an uneven albuminous coat. So we have this uneven albuminous coat and it floats on saturated salt solution. The ovum is unsegmented. Clear crescentric area is present. Coming to the trophozoite of Giardia, the trophozoite of Giardia has a very lovely, beautiful shape. It is like a leaf. It has ventral discs, which has nuclei. It has flagella. It has a ventral flagella and an exostyle. Coming to the cyst of Giardia, the cyst is circular, oval in shape. It has a nucleus, it has exostyle and remains of flagella. Coming to the modified Zeal-Nielsen's staining preparations of Cryptosporidium and Isospora. So in both of them, we can see acid-fast oocysts. So here we have these acid-fast structures. So with this, we come to the conclusion that knowing the morphologies of these different parasites will help us to identify them when we observe them under the microscope by preparing a wet mount. And so identification will lead to the proper diagnosis of the disease caused by the parasite. With this, we end with the discussion of intestinal protozoa.